I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm Dr. Parkins, lead pastor here at Christ Church, and we welcome you in joining us for worship on this fourth Sunday after Pentecost. It's a special Sunday in the life of our church as we move into our summer season and start a new sermon series on the Apostle Paul and what he can teach us in our day about what it means to be a people in mission to God's world. And we pray you will join us over the course of these next several weeks. We also encourage you, if you've not already received a copy of our bulletin, to go to our website at ccumwv.org, where you will see a link where you can download an order of worship and follow us with all of our liturgies and the lyrics to all of our songs that we will be joining in our worship today. So now we invite you. We're so glad you're here with us. So settle in wherever you are. Grab that cup of coffee or whatever you have and join us now as we worship God together.
I'm the Associate Pastor of Family Life here, and it's my joy to serve as liturgist today. So let us all rise in body or spirit as we are able for our call to worship this morning. How wonderful is the word of the Lord! God's commandments are full of wisdom. Through the precepts of the Lord, we gain understanding. In God's word, we find truth. The Lord is our God, and we are God's people. God's work, word, and wisdom lives within us, and God's law is written on our hearts. Living word, great teacher, lead us and guide us. Amen. Let us turn now and join together in praise to the Lord the Almighty. Thank you. I ask you now to join with me in our opening prayer. You, gracious God, are love itself, and perfect love casts out fear. Come to us in merciful patience, we pray, to love us from fear to trust, from anger to grace, from doubt to faith. Love us from our self-centeredness to hearts that willingly give themselves in selfless sacrifice and service. Love us out of our scarcity to hearts overflowing with generosity. Love us from brokenness to wholeness, from resentments and forgivenesses withheld, to forgiveness freely offered, just as it has been freely offered to us. Come to us, Lord, overwhelming us with your love, that we might love as you first loved us. Amen. If you have not already done so, it is time to share the peace of Christ with one another. So I would encourage you to share, to type it in our chat, or those who are in your home with you. If not, please share it with me. The peace of Christ be with you. And it is with all of us. And so we come now to our Gloria Patri. Pastor John, as I said earlier, and we are coming now to a Moments with Children. So I invite all the children in your home or near a radio or TV to come on in close as we gather together. And as we do so, I just wanted to share some good news with everyone. The pastoral staff and the wonderful laity of Christ Church have come together to develop a vacation Bible school for us this year. But it's not like normal because we can't meet all here together like normal. But this is designed for your families to watch and use at your own pace anytime that is convenient for you. It is going to be found on our Facebook page, on our website, and also in our email links for a while coming forward. So if you have any questions about it or haven't been able to get it yet, please just call the church or you can email me or call me and I will be happy to make sure that gets in your hands. But now that we're all gathered together, I wanted to celebrate another story with you, another lesson. The story of Paul starts when his name was Saul. Words can be important, and so can names, because something happens to Saul before he starts being known as Paul. And we're going to hear a little bit more about that story this and next week. But there's a lesson I want to share with you all, and it's a lesson that it's hard for me to talk about because it happened to me too. Can a bully change? I was bullied. It wasn't nice. It wasn't fun. It hurt, and I still remember that. But, you know, I learned to forgive my bully. And I too realized I have bullied other people. I have not always been nice all the time. So I want to share with you two verses from the Bible in the book of Ephesians. And so here is the advice for us, and then the secret of how we're supposed to do it. Put aside all bitterness, losing your temper, anger, shouting, and slander, along with every other evil. Instead, be kind, compassionate, and forgiving to each other, in the same way God forgave you in Christ. You see, real change has a powerful component in it for our lives. Forgiveness. The power of God's forgiveness can change everything. It changed the world through Jesus. It's an incredible gift that God gives us. And because God can forgive us and has forgiven us, we can change. And now, for those people that might have had a bully ask for forgiveness from them, can we trust them? Have they really changed? Is this another prank and they're just going to hurt me again later? Well, I can say that it's possible that that bully has changed because God's forgiveness can enable it. God's forgiveness can change their heart and enable them to be kind and tenderhearted and compassionate and uplifting. And so just like you might have done something wrong and asked God, can you forgive me? Do your best to give those people forgiveness too, because you're one piece in the puzzle that will help them change. Because just as God's forgiveness flows through this world, it flows through you. Just as God's love flows all through this world, it flows through you. So let's take a moment now and say a prayer, thanking God for forgiveness and enabling us to help forgive others. So please repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for your love, for your forgiveness, and for the biggest and greatest gift, Jesus Christ. And so now, let's say a big amen, especially big because I too forgot to say good morning this morning. So here we go on the count of three. One, two, three. Amen! Thank you all so very much. We're coming now to our lesson, a reading for the day. And so and share with you our lesson from the book of the Acts of the Apostles. Sorry, my tongue got twisted. So hear this from chapter 7, verses 54 through chapter 8, verse 1. Once the council members heard these words, they were enraged and began to grind their teeth at Stephen. But Stephen, enabled by the Holy Spirit, stared into heaven and saw God's majesty and Jesus standing at God's right side. He exclaimed, "Look, I can see heaven on display and the human one standing at God's right side." At this, they shrieked and covered their ears, and together they charged at him. They threw him out of the city and began to stone him. The witnesses placed their coats in the care of a young man named Saul. As they battered him with stones, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, accept my life." And falling to his knees, he shouted, "Lord, don't hold this sin against them." And then he died. And Saul was in full agreement with Stephen's murder. And so we begin now our sermon series on the story of Paul the Apostle, back when he was just a young man named Saul.
Oh, hi. I was that young man. It's a long time ago. I hadn't been in Jerusalem very long, several years. I'd moved to Jerusalem to study under the great rabbi Gamaliel. I'd been training all my life to be a Pharisee. I grew up in a city called Tarsus. I didn't live in Jerusalem. I was a Jew living in a Greek city. But I was very blessed. My father was a Roman citizen, so I became a citizen by birth, and his tent-making business was doing very well. We were prosperous. So many, many doors opened for me that some of my friends would never have had. I was able to study under great teachers. Indeed, at that time, When I was a child, Tarsus, our teachers were viewed to be as good as the philosophers and teachers in Athens and Alexandria. And so when I was growing up, I had these tutors who taught me so much. I learned Greek, that wonderful language of our day, and I can still speak it and read it and write it fluently. I learned about the philosophers, and I learned rhetoric and how to argue a point. I was trained to be a scholar, and I loved it. But as much as I love studying philosophy and rhetoric and all those things that these tutors and teachers had been sharing with me, I loved my religion even more. And so I poured myself into learning Hebrew and reading it. I memorized great portions of the Torah. I pored over the writings of the prophets and the other writings in our scripture. I listened as the rabbis expounded upon the text and shared the teachings and the law. But not only did I study, I lived it. I was a Pharisee among the Pharisees. As a young man, I kept all of the dietary laws. I followed all of the practices as described in the Torah and in the books of the law. I lived it. I breathed it. And I did so because I wanted to be a leader among our people. I came from the tribe of Benjamin, that tribe from which our first king, Saul, had come. I was even named after him, though I go by Paul now, but I was Saul. But rather than being the king of our people, I wanted to be a religious leader, a Pharisee. And so I'd moved to Jerusalem as I grew older, so I could study with Gamaliel. And when I moved there and he began to teach, I recognized what a brilliant man he was and how he knew and could expand upon the teachings and the writings. But I didn't think he was strict enough. He wasn't strident enough. He wasn't zealous enough. Oh, he had great teachings. But I felt like we needed more. I felt like we needed to be more like Phineas and Elijah and the Maccabees. Not only did we need to read and study and be pure, we needed to be strident, we needed to be strong, we needed to be zealous for God. So zealous that we would even use weapons if necessary, that we would defeat those who preached or taught against the true faith. That's who I was. But Gamaliel had become complacent. Oh, he wasn't as bad as the Sadducees and the leaders at the temple. They'd thrown their whole lot in with Rome. They were just trying to appease Rome so they could feather their cap and make more money. But even Gamaliel, when this Jesus, this rabbi from Galilee had come to town and he took over the temple and began his teachings, he said, well, just ignore him and maybe it will go away. I couldn't believe it. And so I threw my hat in with the Shammonites. Now, Shammai was a guy, he understood. He was a Pharisee who knew that you had to be strong and zealot. I mean, hadn't Elijah killed 100 prophets of Baal? And shouldn't we do the same? Because if we weren't going to be pure and we were not going to eradicate our faith of these blasphemers, the Messiah couldn't come. We had to be as pure as possible. And so I was zealous for our Lord. And that's why I remember that day so well. The Stephen, the day he was killed and executed. He'd been standing up in our square and he started teaching, telling the stories of the Hebrew faith, all of those teaching and stories of our faith, and he was telling them that it all culminated in this Jesus. He said that he was the Messiah. I couldn't believe it and I hated it. That's why when they drug him outside the city gates, I followed with the crowds. I was excited to be there. We needed to stamp this stuff out before it got very far. Now, I didn't want to get any blood on my hands, mind you, because to be a Pharisee, I couldn't do that. But I could watch. And so I stood to the side, and everybody brought their coats and their cloaks to me, and I stood with them. I watched the men of the town encircle this Stephen as he knelt down and he began to pray. And then they began throwing their stones at him, hurling their rocks at him. And I watched as they hit his body. He continued to pray, but they kept throwing the rocks, and then finally he collapsed. And his prayers became mumbles. And then they became cries. And then he stopped breathing. And then he died. I wish I could say, as I watched his murder, that my heart was changed. But it really wasn't. As a matter of fact, it made me feel even more righteous. And made me feel even more that we had to eradicate not just Stephen, but all of these Jesus followers. And so I thought about how I might be able to do that. And so I went to the religious leaders. They gave me letters of authority so I could go round them up. I thought maybe if I did that, I would make a name for myself. Maybe I'd even have a seat with the Sanhedrin one day. And so I began going around the city, pounding on doors and knocking them in and dragging out these Jesus followers. I took them to the leaders and we imprisoned many of them. Some of them were executed like Stephen. And then when I heard that they had scattered to other cities and had left Jerusalem, I wanted to follow them. So I got some additional letters from the leaders and I began to chase them. Wherever they went, I was going to get them. Because they were disrupting our lives. If they were right, everything I'd ever been taught would have to change. Because I had been taught that we were the chosen one. And that we had to live into this way of life fully and completely. And if there were blasphemers or there were others who were teaching a different teaching, they needed to be eradicated and ran off. I had found my mission. I was going to be Saul the Conqueror and eradicate this blaspheming faith. Because isn't that true that when people come and they disrupt the status quo, when people come and they challenge the way we've always done it before, when they come and they challenge our core understanding of who we are as a chosen people, aren't we supposed to stomp it out, to arrest them, to put them in their place so they won't change things that never should be changed? I mean, God had intended it that we would be separate and by ourselves. We weren't supposed to mingle with the Goyim, with the Gentiles. We weren't supposed to associate with people who are different than us. We were pure. And that's what I had dedicated my life to being. So sure, when they killed this Stephen, it didn't bother me a bit. It made me feel even more so that we needed to put a stop to it. Because when people disrupt things, they need to be stamped down. When people challenge our understanding, they need to be shut up. When people take over our streets with something new, we have to put an end to it. At least so I thought. That's what I had been taught all my life. That we needed to be pure. We needed to be holy. And the only way to do that was to be set apart and to push everybody else away. And so that's the way I lived my life for many, many years. I wish I could say when I witnessed this murder, it changed me. It didn't, at least initially. It took something else to change me. It took an encounter with someone outside of me. It took a relationship with someone beyond me to change my heart. And thank God that change did come one day. It's another story I may tell you at another time. But if I learned anything, I learned that yes, we can change. A leopard can get new spots. And those things that we once thought were most important, and the things that we built our society and our structure around, don't always have to stay the same. They can change. Because if Gamaliel said one thing that did make sense, that when God's in it and change comes, if you're not with it, you end up being on the other side of God. I found that out later. I hope you can find it out in your life too. But right now, I probably ought to go back. My friends in Ephesus are expecting this letter, and I probably ought to go finish it. Bless you now. Shalom. Thank you. Amen. Create in us a clean heart. You know, for many months I've been wanting to preach a series on Paul. He came to mind as a potential sermon series perhaps almost a year ago. And I began to immerse myself in writings about Paul and who he was. And as I learned about him, I recognized he was a man that was filled with some contradictions. Contradictions we see most especially here at the very beginning of our encounter with him in Scripture. For he was a man who felt that law and order was the only way to make it. That without that law and order, without things being as they had been for centuries, without change and without purity and without being set apart and different from the rest of the world, particularly those folks who didn't look like him or act like him or spoke like him, the Messiah wouldn't come. And so he had dedicated himself to eradicating anything that deviated. And as I was reading his writings, and as I was poring over his life, I recognized that in our day, he has something to teach us. He has something to teach us because he was a man who was able to change. He was a man who, through the grace of God, became something different, became something new. And indeed, he became the one who took the word to the very people whom he would have opposed in every way. He was the one who took the gospel of grace to all of those people who looked different, those people who dressed different, those people whose culture was different. Today, as we face the challenges in our nation, challenges regarding difference, challenging regarding the way we've always done it, challenging in the way of thinking about doing things differently, my prayer is that we, like Paul, will eventually change. That we, like Paul, someday we'll encounter that other that is Jesus. The story we'll hear more about soon. But that we will encounter that and be able to make the changes in our lives and the changes in our culture, which are so desperately needed today. My friends, I hope you will join me as we continue to walk with Paul. And I pray that you will stay with me as we walk together in trying to figure out how to change this world so that it can become more like the world that Jesus wants it to be. Amen. And now, as we prepare for our time of prayer, I invite you, as always, to share your prayer concerns through the chat room and the text messages and the things you can do through the computer. We also invite you to send your prayer concerns into us so that we can add them to our prayer list. But now, as we think about our world and the challenges in it, the challenges that our friends are facing, the challenges that our culture is facing, let us sing our chorus to prepare our hearts for prayer, and let us take all of these burdens to the throne of grace.
Surely it is God.
Holy and gracious God, God of the changed heart, the changed mind, as we remember your old apostle, this man Saul who became Paul, we recognize in him so many things that are in us. Those things that motivated him as a young man, the desire for power, the desire for truth, the desire for purity of purpose. And like him, oh God, sometimes these needs of our egos and our hearts pull us down paths we should not tread. Forgive us those times when we've allowed that desire for control and power to cause us to oppress, yes, even kill and harm others. Though like Saul, we don't want to get our hands bloody. Sometimes we don't mind standing at the side and watching and cheering. Forgive us those times, O God. Heal us and change our hearts, just as you changed the heart of the old apostle. Help us, like him, to be a leopard with new spots, a person and a people who, in our encounter with your grace, become changed. And in so doing, set out to change your world, a world that oppresses so many, a world that holds down neighbor, a world that sometimes even kills people simply because they're different. Help us, O God, and forgive us. Be with the needy in our community as we lift them to you, especially those who are wrestling with cancers and other frailties of the body. Bring healing of mind, strength, and spirit. Be with those who mourn and comfort and strengthen them. Be with any who need your grace today, especially those wrestling with addiction and other struggles. For God, you are a God of healing and power, healing of body, healing of spirit, and yes, even healing of culture. Bring that healing upon us as individuals. Bring that healing into our world, so that we may truly walk as sisters and brothers. We ask it today in the name of the one who came to show us this way of healing, your Son, Jesus the Christ, who shared grace and peace with all people, no matter who they were, and that same one who changed the heart of this Saul so many centuries ago. And as we pray in His name, we share that simple prayer that He always invites us to share, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, as we prepare for our time of offering, I again remind you that the ministries of our church continue as we reach out to share Christ's love and grace with the world. We invite you to submit your offerings through electronic means and the other ways that are listed on the screen for you. But most especially, I invite you and encourage you to offer yourself to God today, so that we all can be part of the change that our world so greatly needs. Just give Him your heart, your soul, as well as your gifts today. So now let us join in this time. My friends, every Sunday, every day, we have an invitation. An invitation to offer ourselves to God. An invitation to open our hearts to change. An invitation to seek to live our lives in new and different ways in light of the gospel that we've heard and encountered. So I invite you today to think of your life, where your journey has brought you, and perhaps what needs to change. As we join in our hymn of response, "Change My Heart, O God," a chorus which we will sing a few times, but let us make it our prayer today as we seek to be the change our world needs. My sisters and brothers, as we go forth into this world that is filled with so many things that may cause us fear, so many things that may challenge us to the core, things that may challenge the way things always have been done, may we trust in the grace of this God. This God who changes hearts. This God who changed the life of Saul. May we trust in His grace as we go forth in this world, knowing that we are never far from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.